Today, I'm going to be discussing an ethical legal issue in the field of athletic training. This case happened in 2008, but was not brought into court until 2014. It did happen in the state of California at a local high school, at football practice, between a certified athletic trainer, a student athletic trainer, and a student athlete. It was at this football practice where the athletic training student, who was in an undergraduate program accredited by CATE, was left alone with no preceptor in sight. An athlete went down with an ankle injury and came off the field out of play. The athletic training student did not do any evaluation on this athlete. He taped his ankle and let him return to play. It was on the next play where the same athlete was injured again. However, it was a C-spine injury, and the athlete is now paralyzed from the neck down. There are many ethical legal issues in this case. However, the big one is that the certified athletic trainer left his student alone at practice and was nowhere in sight. The court decided that this certified athletic trainer can keep his license and keep his accreditation. They said that the ankle injury and that the C-spine injury did not correlate, and the athletic training student did what he should have done with no preceptor being there, which was tape the athlete, do a little bit of functional testing, and return him to play. And the athlete was able to perform all the functional tests with no pain after the ankle tape, so he returned to play. However, the athletic training student did not stabilize C-spine when the same athlete went down the next play. And again, there was no certified athletic trainer there to tell him or guide him on what to do. Per the NATA and the BOC, there needs to be a certified athletic trainer with an athletic training student to guide them along and be there at all practices with them, or the athletic training student is not allowed to perform any tasks, which again, he did in this case in California. There are many ethical healthcare principles that were missing in this case. There was no beneficence, which is the difference between right and wrong, what is good, what is right, what risks and costs weigh in the outcomes. None of that was present. There was no right, there was no good. The risks definitely outweighed the costs in this case. There was no non-maleficence, which was doing no further harm, and harm should not be disproportionate to the benefits. Further harm was done on this athlete because he went from having an ankle injury to now a C-spine injury and is paralyzed, and the certified athletic trainer still gets to keep his license and gets to keep his certification as well. So what he did here was unethical and illegal. When it comes to Potter's Triangle, there was really no rule ethics because the certified athletic trainer did not follow the rules, which would have been being at practice with his athletic training student. And again, the athletic training student also did not follow the rules because he performed tasks that he should not have with no certified athletic trainer there. I don't see much goal ethics in this either, because it's a moral theory that deems the ends justifies the means, which really was not, there was no moral in this case. A lot of this case is role ethics, which emphasizes character rather than rules or consequences as the key element of ethical thinking, which is very, very evident in this case. They obviously did not care about the consequences, the certified athletic trainer leaving his athletic training student out at a practice alone. And again, the athletic training student obviously did not care about the consequences because he performed tasks that he should not have, again, without there being a certified athletic trainer there. And he, in the end, both the student and certified are responsible for this athlete being paralyzed. When it comes to Kidder's principles, the main principle that is found is individualism versus community. This is very individualism based. They isolate each person to him or herself. In this case, the athletic trainer, the certified, isolated himself and was not at the practice, which in turn hindered his athlete, and his now student athlete is paralyzed. And the athletic training student also thought really about himself because he performed tasks and didn't do a full evaluation on the student athlete that was injured in the first place. Even though the ankle injury and the C-spine injury don't correlate, it's still two different injuries on the same student athlete that could, one could have really been avoided if the athletic training student and the certified athletic trainer both had done their jobs, the certified athletic trainer being at the practice and the student athletic trainer performing a full evaluation on the ankle injury. Even though he did functional testing and the athlete was able to do it after an ankle tape, he should have done a full evaluation because it could have deemed if he should have sat out the rest of the practice or did not. I do not agree with the court ruling on this case. I believe that the certified athletic trainer should lose his license in the state of California and should also lose his certification. I believe this because per the KD, per the BOC, per the NATA, a athletic training student must be under a preceptor or a certified athletic trainer at all practices until they are certified and licensed in their state, or if their state does not have any regulation like that, or until they are certified, they must be under a certified athletic trainer when they are practicing in their state. The only way they're going to learn is by making mistakes, but again, they're students, so they have that preceptor to tell them what they did right and what they did wrong. In this case, the athletic training student in California did not have that at this practice, and in the end, a student athlete is now paralyzed and cannot play football ever again. So I do not agree at all with this court case. I believe that the certified athletic trainer should have been punished more severely. And I also believe the athletic training student should have been punished because both of them performed tasks that hindered the health and well-being of a student athlete, and now further consequences have come about.